Welcome to the Dog Trainers Podcast, a podcast created by dog trainers, for dog trainers, or anyone who's ever fallen in love with man's best friend.
Episode 15, a deeper look into e-collar dog training.
So let's go ahead and argue a little bit of the anti e-collar points that I used to say, right? So number one, e-collar, you know, back when I didn't like e-collars, we would definitely commonly say like, well, it's cruel, right? And it's cruel because you have to zap the dog to be able to get them to comply, right? And you know, that's always the argument. It's the perception of pain, right? There's this idea of pain, and how it could potentially harm the dog because, as Mariano mentioned before, this idea, we think shock and we automatically think of tasers, right? And we think, the immobilization that happens when people in movies get hit by tasers or people in real life get hit by tasers, right? We also, you know, we also, it's one of those taboo things because, you know, a couple of years ago when I wasn't really into e-collars, it kind of seemed like too much power for one person. Right. It kind of seemed like, man, like, you know, with so much power comes so much responsibility and it would be so easy to fuck a dog up. Right. Mm-hmm. So this was the perception before, like, don't even touch that thing because in essence, you're playing with fire. Right. And so this idea that you're playing with fire, given the wrong instruction, given the wrong, you know, because there are people who just, you know, they said, oh, someone said I should get an e-collar. They go and they grab the e-collar, they slap it on their dog and bada boom, bada bing, your dog's scared of a tree. You know, they're scared of a tree, or they're scared of a trash can. Right. Or they're scared, they're scared of something because that person wasn't coached on actually how to use it. So definitely it also leads to this idea of laziness. Right. So a lot of times a really simple way of looking at fixing behavior is kind of like whack-a-mole. Right. So the game whack-a-mole, where the mole pops up, you hit it on the head with a hammer and it will be over. Right. And unfortunately, what we started hearing and seeing, you know, back when I was first coming up in the e-collar game or before I was in the e-collar game, was, you know, malpractices and bad practices of all this, where people, the dog would bark at a dog and they would crank that thing up to really, really high and they would start pushing buttons. And yeah, the dog would stop once or twice, but eventually either the dog gets preemptive of that shock or the dog learns some self-helplessness, right? And these were some of the studies and stories that we were listening to back in the day. Again, all of these things can kind of be related to bad practices, which we'll definitely talk about later. But these are some of the arguments, right? Also, what a big thing was in where I came up was, you know, you shouldn't put an e-collar on the dog without doing fundamental work first, right? Because a lot of times people just want to solve their problems. So they think, you know, put the e-collar on the dog and just correct all the problems and the dog's going to figure everything out as they go. So that's another reason why it kind of seemed like a lazy training technique. But what I've been told and what I've been taught and what I've researched over the last 4 years of actually experiencing e-collars, it is with the right techniques and the right foundation, someone was able to make it make sense to me. So I that's awesome. So anyways, those were some of my arguments. Are there any arguments that you guys have kind of heard and over the years?
Yeah, well, I've definitely heard it's the lazy shortcut for people who don't really care about dogs type thing, you know, or it's just like, you don't care enough to put in the time. Like, you'd rather hurt your dog than just put in the appropriate amount of time to train your dog with food, the way that science was intended it to happen and stuff like that. Right. That's probably the one that I've heard the most. I was looking up just now the like amperage of an e-collar, because I used to know this information when I first started e-collar training, which was like a couple years before Brent did, was I called Educator like nonstop, and I was just learning everything about him before, because the first dogs I e-collar trained were my personal dogs. And I'm seeing here that e-collars and bark collars come in at about 0.0003 joules, whereas an abdominal like exerciser comes in at like 0.9. So we're talking very low in terms of amperages. And I got that question today. You know, and I used to know like the exact figure for Educator themselves. And of course it varies from like from the boss collars and the macros and stuff. But yeah, I mean, I think a lot of those you know, I know you don't believe this anymore, but like a lot of those arguments are easily kind of shoved aside when you realize a couple things. And we talk about this all the time, but context is everything. So when we talk about somebody being against an e-collar because they're afraid that it's going to cause like pain, or you're going to misassociate something or whatever the case, you can do that without an e-collar. You can easily correct the wrong thing with the wrong collar, or, you know, whatever the case.
True.
And you can even just mess a dog up by reinforcing the wrong thing. Like people with territorial dogs, when they're like, shh, it's okay, you know, and the dog bites your son in the face.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, I think it's worth mentioning that overall, we're talking low, like power output. The job is not to hurt the dog. The job is not to tase the dog. It's got that sort of pulsing sensation. I was trying it today with a client of mine who's going to do a board and train program with me. And she's gone through like three different trainers in like the last, I don't know, 4 or 5 weeks. And she's been just kind of let down over and over. And she was recommended through a friend of hers. And, you know, and I told her, listen, let's do a couple private lessons. We'll get you on board and then we'll take the dog for the board and train. And so she said, okay, you know, so today we started it.
It might be good for the audience. Can you describe what that dog's profile is like?
Yeah. So it's a 5 month old Corgi Chihuahua mix, very nervous and reactive, smart, otherwise like playful dog, but really kind of shut down. Okay. And we're talking everything. Like this dog, when I was over there, was barking at airplanes in the sky, literally. So, you know, and like, and a dude mowing, and a guy mowing his lawn like far away. So, you know, this dog was afraid of everything in their yard. So she was like, man, when I walk this dog, it's like he hates his life, you know? And so she's gone through a few different trainers. One of them was an all treat person. One of them just kind of, you know, just pieced out on her after like a couple lessons and just kind of left her high and dry. Another guy was talking e-collar, but he just, he definitely needs to learn more about how to use one. And I've got examples of that all day long. So I met with her. I explained to her the proper use of a collar in training. There's foundational work with the food stuff, then moving up to the different forms of pressure, ending on e-collar, and how you can actually use an e-collar, not just, you know, with like low level pressure to teach commands, but how you can really start to shape the way that a dog sees things and how they socialize and interact with things and how they, their framework of the world can be drastically improved based on e-collar conditioning. So we, and she works at a hospital. So she was naming like all these different electronic machines that I can't rename.
Like a TEMS machine, Yeah, that's one.
What's the one that, you use to like clear and kind of bring someone back?
Yeah. That's
a defibrillator or something. EKG, whatever it is. There you go. A blah, thing. So like.
Is it an EKG? Anyways, you got it. Go ahead.
Whatever. So the point was she brought that up like in jest. Mm-hmm. And then she tried it and she was like, oh, it's more like a whatever else machine. And I was like, yeah, sure. I was like, yeah, but you know, but I know what she's saying because I was like, yeah, it's kind of like, you know, like muscle stim when you go to, you know, and she was like, yes, exactly. And she jumped right on it. And I was like, see, the people think this, but when you get into the reality of it, it's something else. And then we started talking about how and why this stuff can work. So I just wanted to kind of bring that up to service. I realize you're just playing devil's advocate, but I just wanted to kind of give
half of that. And remember, I mean, I'm very proud to say that I didn't like it and now I was converted. You know what I mean? I think it's a great tool to have in the trainer's toolbox. And I love it. I definitely love the efficiency of it. And a lot of dogs over the years, like thousands, millions of dogs have benefited from it. So let's keep going. Mm-hmm. So as we do every deeper look, let's go into a little bit of the science of it, because, you know, here's the thing is a lot of times in dog training, we hear this term science based, right? And the positive, all positive will claim science based, you know, and even some of the, so we want to kind of argue that, but here's the thing with science based, what they mean is it worked in a laboratory. Right. So this technique, it is proven by science to work. The part that they leave out is that it works in a laboratory or in a controlled environment. Right. And so sometimes because we don't necessarily have the ability to work in a laboratory or a closed environment, you know, some of the techniques that might have been proven to work in a laboratory don't work in real life with real owners. Right. So it's really important that we go over kind of also the science of it. Again, in this episode, we're going to bring up B.F. Skinner and his operant conditioning quadrants. So let's go at it. Right. So I think e-collar work, it does focus on two quadrants that are very frowned upon, but very useful in the development and shaping of behavior. Right. So number one, we're going to talk about negative reinforcement. Negative reinforcement, even though it sounds bad because the word negative is in there, negative mathematically means to remove something. And what we're removing in this situation is pressure, right? And reinforcement is the concept where we want to reinforce or continue a behavior again in the future, right? To motivate that behavior to happen again. So negative reinforcement is what we're talking about. And then also we're talking about positive punishment, which is the adding of an aversive to be able to minimize the possibility that a behavior will happen again in the future, right? So right. We got these two things, negative reinforcement and punishment. In dog training, we call it pressure on, pressure off, right? And then we also call it a correction, okay? So in negative reinforcement, this is an idea. Another way to look at it is we call it escape and avoidance training. So escape and avoidance means we want to teach the dog to escape pressure. So once they feel pressure, how to escape it. And avoidance means they know that pressure will come. So how do I avoid that pressure from coming? Right. And that's usually where the positive punishment comes in. So a very interesting thing that comes in really beneficial, and I want you guys to riff on it a little bit. Mm-hmm. In e-collar training, e-collars are one of the only tools that in dog training that you can add what's called continuous pressure. Right. And continuous pressure means that I can hold a sensation on that e-collar for extended periods of time to be able to snap my dog out of, let's say, a state of mind that they're in or something that they're obsessing over. Mm-hmm. Ultimately what we're doing is we're teaching the dog to yield to a sensation. Right.
Right.
Can you guys talk a little bit about some of the applications of that, like in real life? Like, where does that, why is that important? Like, to people listening, they might be like, what the fuck does that matter?
Yeah. Let me start off really quick and then I'm going to kick it over to Shona because I have a feeling that what I'm about to say is going to kind of head right down your alley. Okay. So, here are a couple of examples of this in play. When we talk about constant pressure, well, before I get into that, I just want to give a quick understanding for other people. And there are, you know, younger trainers who may be listening to this. When we talk about a dog working to avoid pressure, this isn't something that is specific to dog training. Whenever we talk about a dog that's reactive or nervous, or like this puppy that I was just talking about, that dog is reacting to the pressure that it feels for whatever the case. So it's still kind of working under the concept of how do I avoid this? How do I get out of here? And scientifically speaking, whenever we talk about people who are against e-collars because they're not scientific, I think the reason why they do work so well, kind of like social pressure and these other forms of training, the reason why they are so potent is because you're speaking the dog's language, so to speak. The only difference is you're using one pressure to outweigh another. And the difference with that is this pressure is more conducive to everyday life because like garbage trucks and all that, they're going to be there. So if you stress out every time, your quality of life goes way down.
Right.
If I can condition you to avoid pressures in a way that is very specific, that I've taught you first how to get around, you're going to swim way more than you sink. Mm-hmm. And so the quality of life overall goes up. Now to get more to your point, then I'll kick it over to Shona about using constant pressure. There are a couple ways in which an e-collar is not the only way, actually. You can use I've seen people use constant pressure with like a prong collar if they have to, like, it's more like dominant dog collar type stuff where you pick up a dog and hold. And I don't necessarily think that that's the smartest thing to do, but I've seen it a lot more in the context of like literal physical control. Like if the dog is just going nuts and gator rolling, you pick up and hold so that the dog just ain't going anywhere. But in e-collar, you have this ability to apply constant pressure in a way that's very potent. But my thing about e-collar from a scientific standpoint that really makes it stand out, and this is what I put in my blog post about it like a couple years ago, was you can separate leash pressure from e-collar pressure. Uh-huh. So you don't necessarily have to bring the dog in any direction in order to apply pressure. And you can, like, you can pull and hold, which would make it essentially the same in workings as like a prong, but you can choose not to as well. Uh-huh. And it's that sort of dynamic that opens things up. And so I wanted to bring up like, you know, examples of where I see this kind of thing and where they really explain this well is like Sean O'Shea, Jeff Gelman. These guys are some of the more prominent e-collar behaviorists, you know, of the moment. So I want to kick it over to Shona because I know that she follows them closely and, you know, and just kind of get your feedback on this.
Yeah. Yeah, I love both of those trainers very, very much. And I really studied a lot of like their videos and their techniques with continuous pressure. Basically, the way I do it is I use the e-collar pressure with leash pressure together always. Mm-hmm. E-collar pressure is obviously not directional. So you know, if you apply pressure with the e-collar to the dog, it doesn't tell them what to do or where to go, right? Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. then you pair that with the leash, and then that tells them where to go. The way I use continuous pressure is to eventually, I pair it with the leash so that they understand the direction where that pressure should go, like where they should yield their body, if it's a sit or a down or mm-hmm. a recall. Mm-hmm. And then once they've learned that, then you can take the leash away and start to use the continuous pressure just with the e-collar. And that's how you get to be off leash. And that's how I use it. I use them together. I'm not sure if that's exactly what you were asking.
No, that's perfect.
No, that makes perfect sense.